All right, everybody's in. Robert, you there?
Yes, I am. Hey, guys. Hey, everyone.
Brian, you there?
Yes, I'm here. Hello, everyone.
All right, everybody can hear you. So we're just going to do a little test for the next 10, 15 minutes, and then we're going to kick off right on time. What time is it?
I have 6:40.
6:44.
Yep, 6:44. So, and we'll kick off in about 12 minutes. We start the pre-seminar presentations and so on and so forth. So while I have the two of you on the session here, number one, I want to thank you. Thank you guys for offering your time. I know you guys are super busy with the pro stuff, especially during the season. I know now it's kind of slow because we're, you know, due to the crisis, we have to stay home. So we're lucky to have you. But even during the regular season, you guys are always available to help out, and we really appreciate it. So on behalf of all of our RWSO referees, thank you guys for always helping out.
Happy to.
So let me start by Brian, let me ask you a question, quick question.
Sure.
How difficult it is for you? I know it's different, and I'm going to ask the same question to Robert later, right after. How difficult it is for you to unplug yourself from a professional mentality into a college mentality when you're assigned to those games? And the second part of the question is, since you are trained as an assistant referee, how do you do to unplug yourself from the assistant referee mentality to a referee mentality?
Well, the only place that I do assistant refereeing for the most part, except for Dr. Joe gives me two a year, but I only whistle everywhere else. I whistle for Long Island Junior, for the Long Island Cosmopolitan, and the colleges. 90% of my assigners, I should say 99%, give me all middles. So I only run about 25 lines a year, which on the pro level. My mindset's always been as a referee. I just happened to switch over in 2012 so I could get into the Major League Soccer. But how do I change my mindset from a pro game to a college game? Well, one of the things, like I talked about last week, is understanding that the players at a pro level, one, are being paid to be there. One, are semi-seeing themselves as role models. One, their skill level and their speed is better. But when I get to a college level, I start thinking, these are guys that are grooming, especially D1. They're grooming to wanting to get to the MLS, but their maturity level is not there yet. So I definitely have to call games differently than I would in a pro game. So looking at certain things like the little bit of holding, the little bit of shirt pulling, the little more body contact, those things that we let go in a pro game, if you let it go in a college game, will quickly get out of control. Especially as you go down to the Division IIs, the Division IIIs, some of the JUCOs, when they get those rivalries like a Nassau-Suffolk or a Westchester versus Nassau or something like that in our area, you have to be able to control the attitudes of these players because their skill level is not as high. Speed is high, but not as high as a pro game. But the mentality level is definitely not as mature as most professional players. So that's the biggest difference in the pro game to me and the college game.
Good. How about you, Robert? Same question, the opposite. If you ever had to do an AR, a line, you know, how do you unplug yourself? How do you disconnect from the referee mentality? And when you're refereeing college, how you disconnect your pro mentality and to for a college game?
Yeah, well, similar to what Brian said, you know, it's the switch is not as much into, you know, calling what's foul, what's not a foul. It's the level of the contact that it's accepted, that it's not accepted, you know, between the professional level and college level. If it as long as it goes to, you know, I don't do a lot, if at all, lines in college, probably because I suck at it. So it makes perfect sense for the assigners not to even bother with me because I'm just not good at it. I think it's a certain skill that some people do have and some don't. Because of the type of work that I do at Pro, I don't get opportunities to train as an assistant referee, so I don't get to do a lot of lines. Also, the fact that I'm a full-time referee for Pro, it does not allow me to do college game until the MLS season is over, which is usually late into November. This year is probably going to be late into December, so we may not even be able to do, as referees, any college level games. But if I do get college assistant referee assignment, it's a challenge for me. I try to stay focused. I think there's a lot of speed there, like Brian said, maybe not as much speed as it is at professional level, but there's a lot of intensity, there's a lot of emotions, there's a lot of excitement that's associated with those players. So it's a big challenge. And one of the, for me personally, one of the challenges that I have as an assistant referee or as a forward official, if I go into the college level game, is to not to take over the game. And I don't mean that I'm trying to do it. I mean that a lot of referees look at the pro referee being on your assignment and they think, oh, I have to listen to you. If I get there as an assistant referee, if I get to the game as a pro, as a fourth official or alternate official, my job is to help you. It's not to call the game for you. So the challenge is to assist, but not to insist, which, you know, for obvious reasons, some referees think that it's they have to listen to me. So that's basically the challenge.
All right, great. Anything else that you guys want to add?
No, I'm good.
No, I'm good. Good.
You guys are good?
Yep.
All right, great. We're doing good with the test. We're ahead. So it looks pretty good. Might as well just answer some of the questions that were already submitted. And this is basically for the two of you. What do you guys are doing now, since we can't go outside too much, even though some of us can, but let's say for the city people, they can't go out too much. As an assistant referee, can you give me a couple of tips on what they can do at home so they can stay fit? And then Robert, as a referee, if you can give me a couple of tips on what they can be doing at home. So they
You can go outside of your front door, to get a little bit of work. So I remember coming up and Brenda Wright was she just got her FIFA badge as an AR. And she used to always say how at 5 o'clock in the morning, she got up and she ran in her street. She ran five houses down, karaoke'd five houses down, karaoke'd five houses back. She sidestepped five houses down. She sidestepped five houses back. So I know every day I'm teaching from 8 to 3 because I'm a school teacher during the day. And at 3:30, I put my shoes on. And I know last week I said I get workouts from Pro. So I go outside in my front yard and I do my warm up. And it kind of reminds me of the way Brenda did it when she was becoming a FIFA, or she was a FIFA and becoming one, how she stayed fit. I go out in the street and I do my sprints in the street. I do my sidestepping in the streets. I have a decent sized driveway, so I move my cars out of the driveway, park them in the street when I can, and I run in my driveway. I do my high knees in my driveway, my butt kicks in my driveway. I do my opening and closing the door in my driveway. I do my 5 meter sprints, my 10 meter sprints. I do my sidestepping. And then I've made my basement into a little gym where then after that I'll come inside and that's when I'll do my biking or my weightlifting or push-ups and sit-ups and using the staircase to do calf raises and to do not box jumps, but step-ups on the stairs, do lunges off of a stair. So I find stuff in the house that I can use to still get my workouts. One of my workouts last week said, if I can't run outside, run up and down the staircase in my house. So it's something that I don't know where people live, but you could probably find a staircase where you could do step ups to build leg muscles. You can do, if you have a long enough staircase, you could run up and down staircases. But keeping active, because obviously being home, most of us have the ability to eat more and sit down more, and therefore you're going to be getting closer to being out of shape, being harder to get those muscles back in tune. So doing something is very, very important to stay in shape during this time.
Yeah. How about you, Robert? I know you more like me, more country type, but since, you know, over 50% of our referees, they live in the city, and due to, you know, they have to go to the park, and since everything is closed nowadays, what can we give them a couple of tips, and what is it that they can do at home to stay safe?
Sure. Exactly what Brian said. These are the trying times. These are difficult times. This is what separates people that are looking for the excuse over people that are looking for the opportunity. If you're trying to make it, if you're trying to raise your game to the next level, you can find ways to do so. You can end up being fitter after this quarantine that you were before that. It's up to you. And there's numerous ways of doing that. There's shitload of information on a YouTube or anywhere else. You can Google the exercises that you can do at home. You can do on a staircase. You can do on a sprint in on your driveway. You can do it at the on a parking lot. There is no need to think to worry about endurance. Endurance, you can take care of endurance within 2 to 3 weeks after the parks open up, after you can go to the gym to do the treadmill. But you can stay fit. You can stay sharp doing the sprints, doing the sprint exercises. You know, silly things as jumping jacks, as push-ups, as planks, sit-ups. These are the things that if you do it, if you really do it because you want to do it, they're going to make you fitter. So just like Brian said, find the opportunity in anything that you do so you can be sharp, you can stay sharp, or you can actually elevate your fitness to the next level instead of saying, well, there's a great excuse for me not to train. And I encourage everyone to do it, because sooner or later, this will end. You know, we're all hoping that sooner, but whenever it ends, there will be a lot of opportunities for us to referee. There will be a lot of games. And if you're ready, if you fit, you're not going to be as much as injury prone as people who didn't train during this time. So I would encourage everyone to find the ways to stay fit, because there's a lot of ways to stay like that.
Yeah, no, like you just said it, right. And there's so many referees, they're always looking for an excuse. And this is not the right time to look for an excuse. Actually, we're giving them so many opportunities to go ahead and become the best they can be, which happens to be our way of doing things at RWSO. We believe there is room for every type of referees at the college level, from JUCO games all the way up to D1 games. So everybody has an opportunity. The only thing we look for is for you to, you know, always give 100%, 110%, you know, always trying to be the best you can be. We don't ask you to be a Howard Webb. We don't ask you to be a, you know, a Colina or Nestor Pitana or Mark Geiger. We just want you to be the best that you can be today. We know 20 years ago it was different, and 20 years from now you'll be different. Just give us 100% today, and it's always going to be games for you. And I know you guys agree with me. Anything else, Brian, before we go in, or Robert?
No.
Nope, I'm good. Just stay fit, stay in shape. It's not only good for your refereeing, but it's also good for your immune system. So you have one more reason to make sure that you're healthy, you know? So keep doing.
All right, great. So we're going to start. It's almost 7 o'clock. So, Brian, I'm going to give you the mouse so we can get going at 7 o'clock.
Sure.
I believe are there. So we'll go in one by one. All right, you have it, Brian.
I'm just gonna try to move a screen just to see. There it goes. Okay. Ooh. And the arrows aren't working. Let's see. Come on down here. Oh, there they are. You did that? All right. Let's see if I'm working. Okay, I am. Okay. Rob, you still there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay. It got so silent. I was like, oh my gosh, Rich disappeared. Silent. I thought my mouse working. I thought I lost everybody.
No, you're good.
All right, good. So I guess we'll wait one more minute and then we'll get started. I can tell you, Rob, the one thing that's very weird about this, that you, I don't know if you'll find out, but you can't see any people that you're talking to. And you don't know you're gonna be you're just speaking for whatever it is, an hour.
I know.
And it's very weird. Rich will, I'm sure he'll come in. He came in on my presentation last week, and yeah. He would. So at least you know he's there. But yeah. He doesn't keep the mic open for any of the 300 participants. So
I know. And I was actually I was about to text you, to be honest, because I was thinking about that. I was trying to text you that if you want to stick around for my presentation, if you have anything to add during my presentation, I would greatly appreciate it, because one of the weirdest things that I, you know, speaking to yourself throughout the whole presentation, mm-hmm. It's really weird. So if you have free time, if you want to stick around, if you have anything to add to that game management, I'll be happy to have you, because I know how weird it is.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I wasn't planning on staying on this week, but I'll see how things are going at home.
Okay.
If I can, I might leave for a little bit, come back.
No problem.
Yeah, we'll see. But it's definitely an interesting experience.
Are you down with your family chatting thing?
Hi, gentlemen. Todd's on.
Hey, Todd.
Because your time has been up for a long time.
Hey, Todd, how are you?
I'm doing well. How are you guys doing?
We're doing well.
Hanging in there.
Good.
Let me give the mic to Dr. Joe as well, and to Ryan. And then I'm going to let Ryan start it all.
Let's have Dr. Joe say something so we can hear his mic this week before we start.
I'm getting there.
Okay.
Dr. Joe, how are you?
Okay, I just saw that I've been unmuted. I'm here and ready to go. Hopefully everybody can hear me this week.
Hey, Dr. Joe.
So far, this is better than last week.
All right, apologize for last week. It was probably my fault.
Yes, you were loud.
All right, let me find Ryan. Just 1 second, and then we're ready to go. All right, I'll take care of Ryan's audio in just a second. Ryan, the floor is all yours. Go ahead.
Okay, so welcome. For most of us, this is coming back to our second week of the NYSOA/RWISOA webinars. As we're home on this quarantine, we're trying to get some education out to get us ready for the fall season. So welcome back, everyone who was here last week, and welcome to our new members. On our call today, we do have Richard Rodriguez, who is the president of RWISOA. We have Dr. Todd Abraham, who is the senior director of instruction for NYSOA. We have Ryan Sigich, who is head of the NCAA officials, coordinator of officials for NCAA. We have Dr. Joe Machnick, who is a rules analyst, TV commentator, and also the NEC assigner for the women's games, Northeast Coast. And we have Robert Sabiga, who is going to be our main speaker tonight on game management. All right, let's advance. Is it, oh. So here's the people that we said we were going to have tonight. We have Dr. Todd Abraham, we have Ryan Sigich, we have Dr. Joe Machnick, and Mr. Robert Tabiga. Okay, a little bit about who we are. Okay, we're the Rockland Westchester chapter of NYSOA. If anyone's interested in joining our chapter, there's our website, www.rwisoa.org. We handle New York, Rockland County. We're close to Connecticut. We're close to Massachusetts, New Jersey. So most of our referees are from the Rockland County area, Westchester area. Some people from Long Island and New York City have joined up. But if you're interested in joining, we are a member of NYSOA. And we are currently growing. We started with about 14 members, and at the end of this year, we were up to over 100 members and continually growing. Our vision at RWISOA is to have RWISOA's referees regarded as top class officials. By doing this, that's why we have these webinars. We put these on weekly right now for the next 6 to 7 weeks, bringing in talented speakers from all across the soccer world, from USSF, UEFA, SOA, NCAA, Pro, just to speak on various different things. Most of our conversations so far, last week we dealt with conflict management resolution. This week we're talking about management. Next week they're talking about how to prepare for a game. So almost everything we're discussing in these webinars right now is not how to run on the field or how to know what a foul is or isn't. It's really to discuss the psychology of what it is to be a good college official, how to manage the young minds of an 18 to a 22-year-old at varying skill levels and speed levels, so that our first-year referees who have limited experience on the college level, to our eldest members who have been doing this for 20 to 30 years, can all be successful and be regarded as the top referees in the U.S. That jumped. Who's playing with the screen? I don't know. It jumped. Okay, our mission is to give each RWISO official the opportunity to train, develop, and showcase their talent in local, regional, and national venues. And from the NFHS and USSF soccer communities, recruit, develop, and deliver elite referees capable of refereeing at the highest level. The only way people like myself or people like Rich, who are starting to get up there, or some of the elder members can retire is when we bring in new recruits and get them ready to take our places. So we are always looking to recruit newer, younger referees that are interested in doing the college level. And we want to give them the education to be successful and go higher in the NCAA game. All right, there it is. Okay. So this is our website. If anyone's interested in it, it's rwisoa.org. This is where we have our meetings. Everything is posted, and you have about us, joining us, who our members are, contacts. All that information is listed on our website. Here's NYSOA's. As we said, we are a member of the NYSOA, National Intercollegiate Soccer Officials Association. Any interest in joining them, if you're not currently a NYSOA referee, there is their website, NYSOA.com. This is what their webpage looks like. Again, they have home, news, instruction. And as Lance was on last week and has been discussing how NYSOA is going to be putting out in instructions. I know that I was contacted. I know Rob was contacted. Tori Penso is a managing director of instruction right now for NYSOA, and she is putting together a group of referees, like with Teddy Uncle and Chris Penso and Sabiga and Dunn and Corey Rockwell, as well as many others, to put together videos, instructional videos for you guys. This will be posted on NYSOA's website in the near future. And this is all the information for NYSOA you can get off of this website here. Let's see if I can get this back. Ooh, there we go. All right, where are we up to next? Come on. All right, so at this point, hopefully Rich is back, because I think he needs to give the screen over to Dr. Todd Abraham. He's our NYSOA Senior Director of Instruction, who has I believe he has a presentation prepared for you. Is that correct, Dr. Todd?
It is, yeah, a few clips. I was going to spend some time talking about the stimulus quiz program that we started, and I don't know if you're going to give me control or if I have to take control of the screen, show my screen.
I think Rich just gave it to you.
Okay.
On my screen, it says that the presenter is Dr. Todd now.
Okay, so hopefully you can see my screen.
It just came up.
Great, great. So as was mentioned, NYSOA has committed a significant amount of money out of our foundation fund and reserve to try to help referees at this point, where we know they are missing game checks, they're missing opportunities to earn a living. Many of our referee members earn a substantial part of their own income from refereeing, and that's at risk right now. And so we've put together an 8-week program where people will be able to go through a quiz, a 10-question quiz. Those referees that get 100% correct will get entered into a random drawing for the prizes. There are 10 prizes each week, $250 for first prize, $150 for second and third prize, and then $700 prizes for those people who do get it correct and, if you like, win the drawing, which will be done through a random number generator. So the first week of the quiz was just conducted this past week, and the quiz closed earlier this week, I think today. And we have the results and the winners. And what I wanted to do is, we don't have time to analyze all 10 clips, but what I wanted to do was talk about the two clips that were the ones that were most missed or the most controversial on the quiz, and then show everybody the list of the 32 people who did get perfect scores on the quiz this week. And so we had 509 people attempt the quiz. The average score was 71%. And as I said, 34 people had 100% on that on the quiz. So let me go to the first video. And I'll play that one more time for you. Again, please notice the nature of the challenge on this quiz. And so you'll see here that the white player is attempting to play the ball. The black player, in this case, challenges the ball in a dangerous manner, and doing so kicks the opponent. And I think one of the things to focus on here is the mode of contact. So what we're seeing here is the mode of contact being a straight leg with a cleats up challenge. And so clearly the white player here hasn't taken into account the impact that challenge is going to have on the opponent. One might question why this is a yellow card and not a red card. The issue here, or the consideration here, is about the force of the challenge. And so let me go back and show the challenge again. And so you'll notice here the straight leg cleats up challenge, making contact with the opponent, which is why this is a direct free kick, not an indirect free kick. And even though that is done in a manner which puts the opponent in danger, it's not done with excessive force, though merely reckless in nature. Again, want to remind everybody as we look at these that the number one priority here is for us to protect the safety of the student athletes in these situations. And so we really are looking for us to make sure that we sanction this kind of behavior with a yellow card. If you look at the results from this, we did see a little bit less than 20% of the people not seeing the contact, and therefore thinking it was simply either no foul or an indirect free kick, and only about 70% of the people recognizing there was contact there resulting in a direct free kick. The big issue here was whether people should have issued a yellow card or not. And you can see that only a little bit more than half the respondents felt that a yellow card was warranted. But we want to be clear that this kind of behavior, these kinds of challenges require a yellow card sanction, since these definitely put the safety of the opponent in danger. There were some people that wanted to give a red card for this, and I think here this is about recognizing the severity of the challenge and making sure that we have set an appropriate bar for red card versus yellow card. The second clip I want to spend a couple of minutes on today is this clip here. I'll play that again. Pay careful attention to where the foul actually occurs, please, not where the player lands. And so I think this is clear that there's a trip. I don't think anyone would argue that there's a tripping foul here. The questions that one needs to consider, and this clip is trying to bring to light, is the position of the foul. So where did the foul occur, inside or outside the penalty area? And whether there's any misconduct associated with this foul. So I'm going to go back and review that clip one more time to try to focus in on the second that the player goes down during the slow motion here. And you can see from this freeze frame that the foul occurs outside the penalty area. Hopefully that's clear to everybody on their screens. I know it's difficult doing this kind of remote learning. Everybody doesn't have the same video quality as everyone else. But again, freezing it here, I think you can see a couple of things. One is that the foul is outside the penalty area. And then the consideration around misconduct would be, in this case, whether this was a tactical foul. And you can see with the number of defenders here that there are, that this is not a dogso situation, nor is it a, is it stopping a promising attack, in that this attacker has four defenders around him. And had this foul not been committed, it wasn't clear that he had an easy path to goal. So as we assess this situation, we should be looking at this as a foul that happens outside the penalty area. And then you'll see that, as I said, there are four defenders and no attackers around the play. And therefore, this is not a tactical foul trying to stop a promising attack. So as you look at that, the results here, about a 20% of the people thought that foul occurred inside the penalty area versus 4/5 of the people who felt that it occurred outside correctly. And again, here it's critical to pay attention to where the foul occurs, not where the ball is, which was on the penalty area line, or where the player landed, which was inside the penalty area, or the player pleading for the penalty kick by pointing to the spot. And freeze that frame in your mind as you're evaluating the situation on the field. This also requires excellent positioning so that you have the view of the foul relative to the penalty area. And if the referee is positioned directly behind the player, it's going to be very difficult to get the position of the foul correct. 2/3 of the respondents recognize that there was no tactical foul here. But 1/3 of the respondents did feel that this warranted a yellow card. And I guess somebody felt that this was stopping, this is a dogso situation.
Dr. Todd, this is Robert Sibiga. Can I jump in for a second?
Please do.
There's a clue when we're talking whether it's an inside of the penalty area or outside of the penalty area challenge. I don't know if you can back up one slide and pause it at the moment of the contact. There's a clue for the referees to see that it's most likely to be outside. It's the fact that the defender who's challenging for that ball never entered the penalty area. He's coming in from the outside of the penalty area, and he makes the challenge outside of the penalty area. It is very difficult physically to make the challenge inside of the penalty area if your whole body is outside of your penalty area. So if you stop it right here, he never enters the penalty area. Therefore, it's almost impossible. It's impossible for him to make that challenge on the line or inside of the penalty area. That's one of the clues. And I know we're talking about slow motion right now, but take this under consideration that when you're thinking whether it's inside or outside, look where the position of the body of the defender who makes that challenge is. He's outside of the penalty area. Therefore, this challenge is outside of the penalty area.
Thank you. Very helpful. And so just again to review, these are the two clips I covered today and the scores for those. If I have more time, I can do a couple of other clips. I'll ask our
moderator. Go right ahead.
Okay. So I have to go back and unhide some of these. Let me go take some of the clips that I had hidden. And I'll show these clips right here. All right. Do this one clip and then I will see it over to the next speaker. We'll look at that one more time. And so we can see here that the player in the white shirt grabs the opponent to stop the blue player from getting past him. And this prevents the attack from developing. And so I think it's clear here that there's a direct free kick foul, but the question is there misconduct associated with it as well? So as we look through this, pay attention to the nature of the trip and the motion of the defender's feet once he's making that challenge. And it's not the first foot that one should pay attention to again, but the second foot. And you see that second foot come up to complete the scissor, and that clearly puts the situation to the level it requires misconduct. And so this is let me go back a page. And so this is a situation where the white player has acted without any regard for the safety of the opponent and requires a yellow card here as well. This was another one of those clips where we had everybody was clear on the trip, but only 80% of the respondents felt that this was a yellow card, with the other 20% being evenly split between a red card and no card at all. So part of the discussion here and part of the takeaway from this is really to start to get people calibrated on the difference between yellow card, red card fouls here and what it would take to raise this to the level of an ejection in college soccer, and also the fact that a caution is required. So we're pleased by the fact that we're getting a pretty good coalescence around the appropriate decision here, but want people really to understand where the breaking point is for yellow card versus red card. So those were the clips I wanted to focus on today. The review of week one will be posted on Monday when the week two quiz is posted. And I wanted to acknowledge those 34 referees around the country who did get perfect scores on this quiz. So congratulations to these 34 referees. This was posted today on our YouTube channel, and it'll be posted with the review next week. So we really do encourage everybody to take the quiz next week, to enter themselves into obviously the opportunity to win some money. We're also giving those referees who are fortunate enough to not need the financial assistance the option to donate their prize back to the pool, if you like. And so if you are one of those fortunate enough to still be employed, still be earning a living and not require the subsidy from NYSOA, please remember those officials, those other NYSOA members who are in more need at this point in time, but that's purely voluntary. So that's what I wanted to cover today. I appreciate having the opportunity to speak with you. I don't know how we deal with questions, if people ask them in the chat room or if we just move on from here.
They can ask questions. They can put their hands up and they can ask questions. While we look for those questions, does anybody, any other presenters have any questions for Dr. Todd Abraham?
And just Todd is fine. Joe gets Todd. The Dr. Joe. I'm fine with just Todd.
All right, so we're going to have Todd come back in a couple of weeks and give us a full presentation. So we really appreciate that. We're having some audio difficulties with Ryan. I'm trying to solve that problem. I think Tori is here. I don't know if she's available. She may want to say a couple of words.
If you'd like, I can do it. I can continue to work on some of these clips. I have the rest of them here. If you want me to do that while you're getting Ryan on the line, I can go back to some of the other clips that
Sure, if you want to go back and try to find some of those. Meanwhile, Tori, are you online? Are you available to say a couple of words?
I am. Hi, guys.
Hi.
Hello.
Hey, Tori.
I'm just out for my family walk, actually. Just listening in. But we did have a new release on Fridays. We go on YouTube Live at 3 o'clock, and we cover the missed questions that Todd just covered here today with you guys. And we also highlight the winner. So for anyone who wasn't able to join, be sure to check out Quiz 2, which releases on Monday. It closes on Wednesday, and then we'll cover those missed questions again on Friday. So if you want to do webinars all day on Friday, join us at 3 and then you guys at 7. But thanks for having us. I'm glad to be here. It's great to see you guys continuing the education. So I will jump off mute and just keep my ears open. Thanks.
I really appreciate it. Just to give you some stats, right now we have 237 referees online. We have a total of 600 referees that signed up for it.
Amazing. That's fantastic. And hopefully that those numbers just keep increasing as people are hungry for the information. So thanks for providing it, guys. And I think I'll be on next week presenting men's versus women's game. So hopefully everybody joins us then.
Oh, we're going to have a lot of people joining for that one. That's for sure. I'll make sure. Trust me.
Fantastic. Looking forward to it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
You can have a couple of words. If you can say a couple of words related to next week's clinic, if you like, while Todd is fixing the clinic.
Sure. So some of the material was shared at the NYSOA Summit last year. Any of you guys were able to join us then? And then we have some enhancements to that presentation. So we'll cover off on that material. We'll talk about some of the strategies. The physical differences between the men's and women's game. And we will also cover off on some clips, and I believe they're all collegiate clips as well. So we'll be able to highlight some of those differences as well. So looking forward to it. It seems to be a presentation that gets really well reviews from people. I think it's a topic we don't necessarily talk a lot about, and I'm thrilled to see it coming up more often now, as we are more likely to officiate in the collegiate game, a women's game, than we are men's, just a matter of numbers, and Title IX. So that's just a matter of fact. So it's important for us to be familiar of those differences and how we approach the game differently. So that's what we'll talk about.
Well, that's great. And sadly, they're less than, like I'm talking about my group, I have less than 7% of our referees, female referees. Meanwhile, I believe we have like something like, is it like 15 to 10? 15 women's games versus 10 men's games. So mm-hmm. There is a problem there and we need to solve that. So somehow we all need to work together and recruit more female referees. And hopefully right after the clinic, we'll be able to do that.
Absolutely. I'm thrilled to hear that. That is a initiative I'm hoping to drum up with NYSOA as well. So hopefully we can partner on that. That would be exciting.
That will be great. Thank you. Keep up the good work.
Will do. All right. I don't know how to unmute myself.
Todd, it's all yours.
Okay, so I'll show this clip from the women's game, just to follow on from Tori's piece. Right, we'll play that one more time so you have another chance to look at it. And again, notice the nature of the challenge, where the challenge comes from, the opportunity to get to the ball. And so you see that the white shirted player comes in from the side, not directly from the rear, trying to stop the player from getting past her. I will freeze the frame at the time suggested here, just to give you an opportunity to see where the forearm of that white player is. Well, at least I thought I was. I'll try one more time here. And you'll see that the forearm comes into the back while the leg is coming in from behind. So this player is trying, but not successfully, to make a fair challenge. And so the player in the white shirt makes contact both in the middle of the back as well as in the lower leg, and the cleats are down. The challenge is a reckless challenge, but not is a careless challenge, rather, not a reckless challenge, and therefore this should be simply a direct free kick without a yellow card. And as we looked at the results on this, clearly everybody was 100% aligned on foul, although I say that there are 4% of the people who thought there was no foul there. Please don't have them do a game I'm playing. There were 2/3 of the people who thought there were no card, and 1/3 of the people who felt there should have been a yellow card associated with this challenge. Again, I think in a Division I game like this that we're looking at, this kind of a foul and the manner that it was executed here is something that was simply careless and doesn't raise to the level of misconduct. Well, I know it's difficult to take these things out of context and look at them and see if they're misconduct warranted, but this foul taken just as a single incident is something that we believe does not require a yellow card. And again, happy for any of the other presenters, for Dr. Joe to weigh in on this. I think it's helpful to get perspective, or anybody in the audience who wants to ask a question about that. If not, I'll go to one of the other clips that maybe were a little bit less clear. Try this one.
All right, okay.
Is Ryan, do I hear Ryan on in the background? I'll do this last clip and then I'll turn it over to Ryan. All right, hopefully this is pretty clear. Let me play it again. Obviously, one of the clues to you as a referee is the heavy touch and players moving at speed. Referee is in a good position to see the contact, and you'll see that both players are moving at speed. The white player uses high speed and intensity when challenging, and this is clearly something endangering the safety of the opponent. If you notice the leg contact here, I'll play it one more time. You'll notice the defender comes in with a straight leg as well. Brings that leg up to make sure that the contact is effective, if you like. And this is a game between two local universities, FAU and FIU. So in matches like this, you have to expect that you're going to see these kinds of this level of intensity, which may or may not lead to these kinds of excessive force challenges. But in rivalry matches like this, one has to pay particular attention to this. And this would be an example of serious foul play. It's important to know this is serious foul play and not violent behavior, and that will continue to be important as we understand the differences in penalties associated with the two. And as we look at the 2020 rules changes that have been recommended I know they're not finalized yet, and I suspect Ryan will talk a bit about this. There will be different penalties for serious foul play and some aspects of violent behavior. So it's important that you recognize the difference between violent behavior and serious foul play, as that plays into the number of games a player is suspended. Again, any comments from the other presenters or any questions that people have on this clip?
So Todd, this is Brian.
Yeah.
This is Brian Dunn. So last week we were talking about conflict like resolution, and we were talking about challenges like the first one you showed where the girl kicked the girl in the foot. And we're saying, like, if it smells like a foul, looks like a foul, call it, and it'll make your game simpler. So in a game like this, if you see a challenge like that and you come out with a yellow card, you've just set the bar so high with the types of challenges you are going to see in that game, where basically you need an ambulance to get a red card. Your game is going to go down the poop chute, as I said last week, so quickly if this is not a red card in your match.
Yeah, what you're saying, if you don't give a red card, is you're allowing 20 of these challenges during the game.
And they all have to be sanctioned the same way, because you said it was yellow in the 30th minute. So that has to be a yellow the rest of the game. And if you do that, that's a disaster, especially for some of our first and second year referees that are asking, what's it like to do college games? What can you advise me as a first year referee? Is have cojones and pull a red card on that. And your respect factor will go up with the coaches, with the players. And that'll establish you as someone that knows the difference between what's a yellow card and a red card in the college game.
And I know a lot of referees don't want to throw a player out of the game. They feel it's almost a badge of honor to finish the game with 22 players. Now, Mike Kennedy, who is a FIFA referee from Chicago, who I've had the opportunity to interact with many, many times, and is a great referee and really well-versed in a number of these things, says, don't put that on me. I'm not throwing you out. You're the one that did that. I'm just evaluating the severity of the challenge and issuing the appropriate sanction. So you're not throwing the player out. The player threw himself out.
Correct. He earned that card.
And this one he earned really, really well.
Mm-hmm. All right, great. Thank you. Thank you, Todd. That was very helpful, very useful. We really appreciate it. I know the referees really appreciate it. Quick question. Do we have these videos uploaded in the NYSO website yet so we can direct all these referees there?
These videos, as Tori mentioned as well, will be posted on the YouTube channel when we put the quiz quiz number two out. So this was quiz number one. These were on the YouTube channel. People could view them and enter their results in. That entry is over now for the first week, but when the second week quiz opens up, the first week results, this video that I'm showing you right here, this exact presentation, will be available on the NYSOA YouTube channel and on NYSOA.com for you to be able to access.
Very well, and I make sure that my social media people, I put a link in our website as well so we can direct the traffic there so they can see these videos. Todd, once again, thank you very much. Thank you for your time. I know this is like an hour long clinic, but you were kind enough to reduce the time so we can have the other presenters, since we have so many presenters coming in all at once today, which is a great thing. But we just want to give everybody a little bit of time so they can share a little bit of their experiences with everybody as well. But I promise you, we'll be in touch tomorrow, the day after tomorrow, so we can set up a day so you can have a full hour to share all your experiences and all your knowledge with the group. Is that fair?
That's great. Thanks. I appreciate it. Look forward to participating in future sessions. And I'm really happy to see the chapter doing so much online training. Now, one of the things you'll see from NYSOA over the summer is a lot more online training, as we all want to make sure we stay as current with the game as we possibly can, as we unfortunately aren't on the field as much as we'd like to be. So you'll see many more opportunities for online training, not only from your local chapter like you're seeing it, but also from the national office, and we're happy to be able to provide that. So thanks for the opportunity today. I'm going to stay on and listen to Ryan as well and to the other presenters. So thanks for that opportunity.
Thank you, Todd.
Thank you, Todd. Okay, friends, from a conversation I had with Rich Rodriguez, our main host for this evening, we were having some technical issues getting Ryan Sigich to be able to speak to us tonight. We didn't want to have a situation like last week with Dr. Joe where we weren't going to be able to hear everything he was going to be able to say. So unless Rich has been able to fix it in the last 5 minutes, we're not going to hear Ryan Sigich tonight, and we're going to move on to Dr. Joe and Rob Sabiga's presentation on management. Okay. So we have Robert Sabiga, who is a 2018 MLS All-Star referee. He had the All-Star game down in Atlanta, and he's been in the league, four or five years now? You can correct me if I'm wrong, Rob. Is it four or five? How many years you've been in?
Yeah, I've been a full-time referee for 5 years now, yes.
5 years. And we also have Dr. Joe Machnick, who is a Fox Sports analyst. He's the NEC Women's Soccer Coordinator, a NYSOA Hall of Fame, and a National Soccer Hall of Fame. They are going to co-teach tonight's management presentation on how to manage the college game successfully. It's on you guys.
All right, Robert, Dr. Joe, are you? Do we have you today?
I am. I'm here.
Very good. Do we have you, Robert? Do we still have you?
Yes, I'm here. Can you see my screen?
Not quite yet. We will. I want to double check with Ryan. Ryan, can you hear us? No, we're still having some technical difficulties with Ryan, but I promise you.
Ryan just texted me. He says he's on, but he's muted. I don't know if he's on as a panelist or if he's on just as a attendee. I don't know if Rich, if you can sort it out. We are happy to stop our presentation at any time and have Ryan take the microphone.
Yes, so we'll do that. We just go ahead with your presentation and. And then when appropriate time, we'll jump in. All right.
Okay.
Now just send me a text, text me his phone number and we'll go from there. How's that?
Sounds good.
All right. Dr. Joe, how are you?
Yes, fine. Thank you.
It's all you and Robert. Go right ahead. I gave Robert the power.
Okay. How do I put my screen on? I'll show my screen. Is that what it is?
Yeah.
Do you guys see it?
Yep.
Yes.
All
right. I'm going to apologize in advance. I don't usually do this, so all of the technical difficulties I'm going to blame Rich Rodriguez for. But let's get to it.
And what else is new?
Yep. All right. So game management in college soccer. It's a topic that a lot of people don't want to talk about. A lot of people find it difficult. You know, it's easy to make a decision on a foul. It's easy to make a decision whether it's something, which way we need to go with a throw-in or a corner kick. Game management, it's a little bit of a higher level. And it's something that's really is lacking and it's very much required in college soccer. The first screen that you guys seeing here is the picture of my first recollection of meeting with Dr. Joe, who's also on the line, and who kindly agreed to do this presentation with me. This is from 2012 Armed Forces Tournament in San Diego, California. This was some of a mind-blowing experience personally for me, because back then I was only referee for three or four years. I got invited to this tournament and I got assigned a game. It was Army against Marines. back then, I already did a couple of games at West Point and college level, and I thought, okay, so this is what I should expect, and it's fine. What I didn't realize is I'm going to be refereeing soldiers, the real soldiers who a couple of weeks ago came from Afghanistan, who were really on a war zone, and now I'm going to be a referee of these guys. About 10 minutes in, there was a crunching tackle coming from both sides. There is a 50-50 ball, two players coming in. One is flying in with cleats exposed. The other one is flying with the cleats exposed. They both missed the ball. I'm running in. I'm about to blow the whistle. I don't even know which way I should blow the whistle because it's absolutely unbelievable challenge that I've never seen before. By the time I got there, both players got up, they helped each other up, and they continue playing without any complaining at all. So I'm like, okay, so I guess this is how we're gonna play this game. I didn't blow the whistle for the foul. I let them play. In the whole game, I think I maybe called 5 fouls total, and there was absolutely no dissent. There was absolutely no complaining from anybody in a game. And I'm talking players, and I'm talking coaches, fans, anybody. So it was really a huge experience that I've never experienced before. And at the end of the game, Dr. Joe was my assessor, and he said, "What did you think about the game?" And I really didn't know what to say, because it was not what I was expecting, but at the same time, I didn't get any message from the players or any message from the coaches or anybody else for that matter, that I'm not doing what I'm supposed to be doing. And that was one of the most important lessons in my career, when Dr. Joe, after the assessment in which, you know, he killed me for that game, it was, he told me the sentence that I remember until today. Sometimes what players want is not what players need. And it really resonated with me, because this was a perfect example for that game like that. The players didn't complain. As soldiers, they have implemented the respect for the authority. And in that game, I was the authority for that. So, not getting any dissent, not getting any complaints, doesn't necessarily mean that I did a good job. Dr. Joe, can you hear me? Can you mention anything? Do you remember that game?
Well, absolutely, Robert. And you know, I think what else I said to you is that as a referee, when you come onto the field and they announce your name, today's referee is Robert Sabiga. Well, Robert Sabiga needs to know what a good soccer game looks like, or any referee. And when a game deteriorates to that level, because this is the way players want to play, and it's not really soccer, it's something else, and I think you would agree with that, then it crosses your line. You have to have a look. You have to know what a good game looks like, and you have to know which fouls, which misconduct, what behavior crosses your personal line, and you need to set a bar that's high, because you're wanting to advance as a referee, but you want to protect the safety of the players, but you want to protect the game of soccer as well. So I think you at that time, you know, you let the players take charge. They were in control. They didn't complain, but you didn't referee that game. And that's why I came down on you, and I appreciate the fact that you considered it one of your life lessons in your development of soccer. Now, it should be said, Robert, that you know you are a player's referee. There's no doubt about it. There's a reason why I think you received your 100th medal in MLS faster than any other referee in the history of MLS. I believe that's true, and so part of it is your game management, but part of it is that you know what a good soccer game looks like, and the players know when you show up, okay, they know what to expect, and that you know, you're going to referee the game that you want, not necessarily that they want. And that's not to mean at any time that we're taking skillful play or anything like that out of the game. It's the reverse. It's the opposite. We're providing an atmosphere where skillful play can be exhibited. We didn't see much in that Army versus Marines game.
Absolutely, absolutely, and I think that's the way of us getting better as referees. You know, we pick the game, we do the game, and then we receive feedback, and we're trying to get better at it. So the game management will not only be a successful game if we didn't pull the red card in a game, if we didn't pull the yellow card, or if we have low number of fouls in a game. It's also what is expected in that game, as opposed to what players are willing to accept. So moving on, what is a game management? You know, what is a soccer understanding? This is exactly what, you know, I lacked in that game back in San Diego. I didn't understand the expectations of this game and protecting the players. They were willing to accept my decisions, even though they were not expected decisions. And that's something throws us off, that the players will not dissent, or sometimes they will dissent too much. So there is a difference between expected and accepted decision. And I think it's important for the game management perspective to understand that. And we will learn earn the trust of the players if we call the game the way the soccer world expects the calls to be made. As far as the when the game management is required in a match, there's a numerous place when the temperature of the game changes, and it's our job as a referee crew to recognize that and to be able to adjust based on what's going on in a game. Also, when the score changes, how do teams manage the game? There is a difference between the away team scoring a goal. They're going to play differently from that moment. As a game manager, who the referee is at that moment, it's important to recognize that. It's important to expect that. It's important to understand, okay, we're going to see much more time wasting. We're going to see much more possessing the ball over trying to play quickly. And on the other hand, if the team is losing, how are they going to adjust to that situation? What do the coaches tell them to do? All of that plays a role in a game management. And as a referees, we need to understand, what do we do well with this? When do we recognize it? And make sure we recognize it well. So with soccer understanding, what do we mean by soccer understanding? Being one step ahead means to understand what's coming, to understand the time of the game, the score of the game, the temperature of the game. And I'm going to show some clips that I don't know how fluid or how choppy they're going to be. Just a note, in the whole presentation, there will be a lot of clips, but I just want everyone to know, none of those clips are designed to criticize the referee, criticize the official, because every single decision on those clips are defendable decisions by the laws of the game, okay, by the rules of the competition. It's not about the referees, it's about what do we allow in a game and what are the consequences of those decisions.
Just in case, can you post it for just a second? Just to let everybody know. Yeah. This presentation is going to be available tomorrow on our website, and we're going to share it on our Facebook site. So all the videos will be very good tomorrow, if okay. Anybody has a problem. And Ryan, we finally made connection with Ryan, so later on we'll have Ryan say a couple of words. Sorry.
Okay. That's all right. Okay, so just to jump in, there was a lengthy play when there was a lot of opportunity for the referee to make the call, to call the foul. In every single one of them, he decides this didn't reach the threshold of a foul, and that's fine. But when you see a reaction of the team after the ball goes out of bounds, they are not happy. You can see that there's a unhappiness about the certain decisions, and it's something for us to recognize. When maybe we set the bar at certain, I'm sorry, this is too early. Maybe we set the bar at certain level that they will continue to play, but you can see that they're not quite happy with the decisions that were being called on the field. And now, just a minute later, you have a situation where he needs to make a decision against the red team. And now he's being surrounded by the players who are unhappy. This is not just about this call, which was a correct call because it's a foul, but it's a whole picture. It's the whole 2 minutes that were happening during this game where it felt that every decision or non-call on the field was going against the red team. So finally, when he blows the whistle and he calls it against the red team, there is an amount of dissent that we see by the red team. I want you to take a look at that challenge right now when the white player is going to turn and start going forward. This red player has no opportunity to play the ball, and he kicks the white player from behind. It's absolutely a foul and at least a yellow card. We can discuss whether it's a red card or not, but it's not being called by the referee. The next foul is being called, which is much lower level of the foul, and yet it is being called. So from the perspective of the game management, the question becomes, did those two calls were justice given to the white team? Okay, and again, this is not to criticize the individual decisions. This is to realize the temperature of the game changing because of certain decisions or calls or non-calls that are being made in the game. Okay.
So, Robert, Joe Mack here. I hope everybody's looking at the score and looking at the time while they're watching this clip.
Yes, sir. And this clip is specifically about the time management by the referees. There is obvious winning by the yellow team 2-0. It's the end of the game. We are lucky that the white team is very professional team and they're not making big deal out of this, or maybe they already gave up because they know they're going to lose the game. But this is the opportunity for a lot of frustration and a lot of anger coming from the losing team. Yellow team is obviously wasting time, and it's something that we are supposed to recognize as the referees. It's something that we cannot allow to just happen. We have to expect that if we continue like this, some things may happen. And when you look at this blue bar that I have on that screen, You can see the fouls committed by one team are down low, but the yellow cards are given to the other team. It's the appearance of lack of balance. You can see that one team is committing fouls, yet the other team is receiving a yellow card. That's the type of a game management that we as the referees, and look, don't get me wrong, games like this happen. There might be fouls, small fouls committed by one team and the other team is committing big fouls, and every time they commit the foul, it's a reckless foul in nature or stopping promising attack, and we have to give the yellow cards. So I'm not saying it's incorrect. I'm not saying it's wrong. I'm just saying from the game management perspective, it's something we need to recognize, because what we are going to have is the team that's on the receiving end of the yellow cards, they're going to feel the sense of injustice. They're going to feel that it's imbalanced, and we're going to have to deal with that type of a frustration.
Robert, you're talking about some very sophisticated stuff here in terms of, you know, do you referee the time? Do you referee the score? Do you referee balance of fouls? These are things that we didn't talk about in soccer 30, 40 years ago. This is the modern game, though. You can't survive as a referee unless you really feel the game and you know what the teams are doing, you know what the players are doing at all times. And what you're talking about, soccer understanding, is a feel for the game. And I know a lot of people on the call have heard the German terminology, Fingerspitzengefühl. Even Kalina used it in a presentation, and that means feel for the game, and that's the essence of game management.
Correct.
That's correct. A great point, guys. This is Rich here. Just a great point. Now, can you give us some example of how to manage that at the college level, since we have a clock?
Well, obviously, we are able to stop the clock, and we are able to deal with that situation, and we should, unless there is no complaining from the other team. If they've given up, then we kind of have to kind of read the room and read the temperature of the game. But in general, as far as being fair to the other team and allowing them to have a fair shot and fair shake to the game, we should be able to stop the clock and talk to the players, maybe perhaps even talk to the coaches through the fourth official, alternate official, to tell them that we know what you're doing, we're recognizing this, and we don't want this to continue, because otherwise we're going to be stopping clock on every stoppage. The player who's able to play inch perfect pass at 40 yards, is unable to pick up the ball at the sideline, is not tired enough to do that. He's playing you, and we as the referees, we need to recognize that, because it angers the other team.
Thank you.
All right. So when will the game change? The game will change upon the change of the coaching instruction. The game will change when one player does something to embarrass the other team, the other player, when there is a frustration, when the game is lopsided, when they lose the goal, when they were trying hard and they lose the goal, the temperature of the game will change. Those spikes, we are responsible to recognize those spikes. When there is a perceived injustice at the call, meaning there is a controversial call that the referee makes and it's not accepted by the other team, that will change the temperature of the game. And if there is a, you know, and this happens a lot in college level, because there is a short season, so these teams see each other a lot. This happens a lot in the women's game, I'm told. I don't do women's games because I'm not good at them. But there's a history. If there's a history.
Robert.
What's that?
We can talk about that.
You know, I'm sure Tori will mention, you know, differences between the men's and women's next week. But the history between the players or the teams, there is a rivalry teams that they play against each other. There's much more to it than just win or lose that game. And, you know, between the players individually, especially with women. There is a, you know, they remember stuff from last season. They remember stuff from their youth season. And that's something we're not going to be able to research that perhaps, but we need to be able to pick up those clues during the game and see that, hey, when we blow the whistle, the first couple of minutes, oh, this is not going to be a normal game. This is more than just a normal game. And that's something from the game management perspective, we need to be able to recognize that. Joe, do you want to add something?
Robert, so yeah, I mean, just like in the Northeast Conference end of the season, two teams played each other on the final game day, final regular season game day, and they wound up a week later. The same two teams had to play each other again in the first round of the tournament, of the NEC tournament. So everything that took place in the game 5 days ago, 6 days ago, carried over into the next game and made for a very, very difficult game for the referee. So you're absolutely right about rivalries and, you know, how many times they play each other and what they remember from previous seasons.
Correct. Okay. So let's continue with the soccer understanding and being one step ahead. I'm going to start with a couple of clips, and we're going to talk about a few of them. And the first two is going to be an example of making a big call and being able to have the presence at that call and make sure that it will land your respect from the players. So let's start with this one. Okay, so let's talk about it quickly. It's obviously a red card for a Doxo, and it's a correct decision. The one thing that I'm trying to point out here, it's a second minute of the game. Sometimes we are not sharp at the very beginning. We don't expect the big call to come in that early. And the point of this is, once you see this play, once you see that play, that ball being played, once you see this, there can only be one decision to be made. If it's a foul, it's a Doxo. Okay? And as referees, every once in a while, we get this gift of getting a play like this, which at the beginning of the game, we can earn respect from both teams if we run in with the red card in your hand, giving it red card right away. Because if it's a foul, there's absolutely no way to think about it. However, because the referee was caught off guard and because he ended up with the correct decision, don't get me wrong, so it's absolutely defendable. It's a correct decision. It's a right decision, the only decision you can make. But if you run in at that play with the red card and you give it right away, you don't spend 2 minutes explaining your decision to the rest of the team. And that's the difference between earning that respect right off the bat with the correct decision right away, or trying to earn that respect later on. So that play ended up with a red card. It took 2 minutes to settle, but about 4 minutes later. Let's see if I can, okay. And then about 7 minutes later, you have another play. So we have another play 7 minutes later, and you have both teams coming at the referee, complaining about the decision. He didn't even make a decision yet, and both teams are already complaining. Obviously, one team is hoping to get the red card out of it. The other team is hoping that it's not going to be a red card. But the whole situation is messy because 7 minutes before, on the first play, he didn't grab this play and he didn't earn that respect and that trust by both teams. Dr. Joe, do you have anything about that?
Well, you know, when you get a red card so early in the match, you're gonna have players trying to fool the referee also to giving a second red card to even up the score if the referee's really not confident in the first red card decision. So you have to think about that as well. That's part of understanding the game.
Absolutely, absolutely. So you have to know that for the rest of the game, you're gonna have to be strong. Your body language needs to be strong, and you have to be right on the money with your decisions. So that's one example of big calls lend trust early in a game. If you have an opportunity to grab this game by the balls, you should absolutely do that.
Yeah, if he mentions horns. That's the a Polish word. Can you just post it for 1 second? I wanna go back to the other video if you don't mind, because it's sure. Very important. I understand at the pro level, even though it wasn't managed 100%, right? It still worked a little bit because of the, you know, we in a professional environment, people getting paid a lot of money. The league do something silly, they'll find you big time. But at the college level, and especially at the JUCO and Division III and even Division II, you have situations like those two type of plays. Most likely, you're going to end up with a mass confrontation. So, yeah. While if you don't mind, which
video do you want? First one or second one?
The second one, the one right in front of the benches.
Yeah.
Can you offer to the people listening some tips and how to manage this situation in a college game? Because I can assure you, those coaches will not behave that way. Those substitute players will not behave that way. And the field players will not behave that way. So what can you offer to the people listening? What kind of tips can you offer them so they can manage what's about to happen to them?
Right. So obviously the first thing you need to do is to stop the clock, because this is not going to be a quick restart. This is not going to be a situation where you're just going to blow the whistle for the foul. And I think it's crucial for us to first of all, have a teamwork to recognize which player committed the foul, so we don't lose him in that whole mass thing, which was about to happen anyway. So it's important to stop the clock. It's important to recognize which player is committing the foul. It's important to allow the trainer to come in to check the player. But it's also important to have the command presence. It's important to be the boss of the situation. Make sure that the players see that you are in charge. Make sure that we don't get influenced by the players. And if we can it, potentially, depending on your body language, depending how strong you are, if we can separate the offender from the rest of the team, it would be ideal. You know, sometimes that means to get him outside of the penalty, outside of the area where the other players are, to make sure that you get to talk to him and you punish him accordingly for the challenge. But for me, the presence in that moment is crucial, and to make sure that you sell the decision to everybody else so they can see that you know what you are doing.
And let's make sure that AR1 and a fourth, an alternate, if it's available, they do what they're supposed to do.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
All right. So we're moving on to tactical fouls that we decide to sometimes deal with, or sometimes we decide to deal with the yellow card. So this is the beginning of the game, the 20th minute of the game. And there is a holding foul right here. Okay. So, and this is the foul that the referee decides to deal with. with just talking to. Okay, it's a correct decision. It's a beginning of the game. It's early in the first half, and the referee decides to deal with it. It's a foul against Colorado, against the white team, and the referee comes in and he speaks with the player who got fouled, who got held, right? Again, my suggestion would be not to ignore the player who committed the foul, because from that play, and I'm sure the referee talked to him afterwards, but I think at a college level, I think the acceptance of the call is going to be higher if we make sure that we talk to the offending player as well. And now, at about the same time in the second half, we have the similar foul committed in a similar area on the field by the other team right here. Okay, and now this foul is being punished with a yellow card. Okay, again, it's a correct decision. It's a defendable decision. Both of them are correct decisions. However, there is going to be a sense of injustice if we continue like this in a college game. One team they just got talking to, the other team received the yellow. And I understand a lot of things could have happened in that game that made the referee go that route. But when you see the body language of the white player who committed that foul, he's going to be telling the referee that this is his first foul. Look. Right here. It's my first. And which could be true, but the temperature of the game was recognized by the referee, and he said, enough is enough. I cannot allow it. So while I understand trying to manage the place with just talking to instead of the yellow cards is a good tool to have in your toolbox, you have to understand the danger of it, that once you set that line that I'm going to be managing holding fouls in that game, and then suddenly you change that in the second half, or because of whatever the reason happens, there will be sense of injustice in a game. Dr. Joe?
You know, in another sport, in basketball, there's a book out that they call this call sorting, S-O-R-T-I-N-G. If you make a decision at one end of the field, and that's your decision, when you get the same foul at the other end of the field against the other team, the same sort of foul, then you got to make the same decision. And you can't not give a yellow card and then give a yellow card. I mean, what I think needs to be said also about that first foul is, how do you make that decision not to give a yellow? I mean, yes, there's multiple defenders back, so you could say it's not stopping a promising attack, but soccer's not supposed to be played with the hands and arms, and you grab a player's arm and hold him back like that is a cautionable offense.
Correct. There's nothing wrong with taking a chance, but you have to realize that with taking the chance, there are consequences of your decision, and you're going to have to carry on with these consequences for the rest of the game. Or if you change those, there will be dissent coming from the players or from the teams.
I mean, some people use the word consistency, but it's such an overused word that half the time you don't know what it means. So,
correct.
So, you know, so I like that word, calls of the same sort. So you got to make the same decisions.
Correct. And then look at the end of the game. This is a different game, and this is obviously a tactical foul. And I want you to take a look at the decision itself. I want you to take a look at the command presence of the referee. He's 100% in charge. He doesn't have to wait for the player to come back. The players knew what he was doing. He's accepting the decision, and he gives him a thumbs up. That's something we're looking for. There is nothing wrong with you're supposed to be recognizing those fouls, and you're supposed to be punishing those fouls accordingly. And guess what? The players will respect that because you called it right. Even though this is against him, He's fully aware what he was doing, and that tactical foul showed with calm with the presence of the referee, it allows everybody to say, hey, this referee knows what he's doing. Nope, we already saw that one. And these are the, okay, these are the Rich Rodriguez's fault, which I'm going to blame for. Again, another three clips that we're going to talk about soccer understanding. So we have a long ball going in, we have a goalkeeper coming out, and we have a player charging at him. Okay, I would like to point out that one of the prettiest things, one of the most beautiful things that we can do is allowing the advantage in a game, especially if it ends up with the scoring opportunity or perfectly in a goal. However, we have to recognize also the safety of the players as well, and especially at the college level, we want to move to the side of the safety more than we're trying to allow the flow of the game, that we're allowing to get them a chance to score a goal. This challenge happened all the way in a defensive third, and that's something that this beautiful ball being played in our ideal minds, and for those who play, I don't know, FIFA on their computers, there's a great scoring opportunity there. But it's important not to forget that the safety of that player is our priority, especially that this was a goalkeeper, right? So imagine they lose the ball here and they're trying to attack. You as a referee is going to be stuck between stopping the game because the goalkeeper is hurt because of that challenge. Even if you didn't think it was a foul, even this one probably was, but just recognize the fact that the safety of the player is the most important thing that we need to look for.
Okay, Rob, can I stop you for...
Yep.
So on that play, I was AR. I was the one standing there. And okay. Unfortunately, on this play, what you were saying, what he saw going forward, he didn't consider the safety of the player to the advantage. He had thought that ball was going to give a scoring opportunity, and didn't think of the possible head injury that we had on that situation. And that was one of the things in this match where we had discussed, even with the assessor after the match. In a college game especially, this is one where player safety has to be first and foremost, and forget about that possible advantage or a possible foul being closer to the goal, which would be a better advantage for the team that was fouled, because this took a long time. One guy had his face split open because the forehead hit another guy in the cheekbone, and this took about 5 minutes to get this game restarted from this head injury.
I just found this clip. I didn't even realize that you were on the game, but I'm glad you're on the call and you cleared that up. Especially at the college level, I think it's crucial for us to think safety first. And if you're an AR or a fourth official of anyone who sees that, I think going over radio or popping the flag right away and say stop the game, will allow the referee who maybe didn't see it clearly, maybe he didn't think this was a foul, think of the safety of the players first, and that will earn a lot of respect from both teams as far as the game management goes.
So Brian, how did this end up? What was your communication with the referee once the game got stopped?
Well, as soon as it happened, as soon as the collision happened, I had foul and my flag is going up and he says advantage. I actually called the trainers onto the field while he was playing the advantage because I knew it was a head injury. And then as soon as Alan got there, Alan looked at me and he was like, I think it's number two. I forget who the player was. I think it was number two. And he's like, yellow card, number two, challenge late. And we're like, yes, 100%. So we waited for both players to be treated, and as soon as the player stood up, Alan showed the player a yellow card for the late challenge on the goalkeeper.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. All right, let's go to the next one.
And while that's coming up, I think what you were saying about in the college game, 100% player safety. I mean, that is our number one goal. These kids have to go back to class the next day, hopefully. And anything we need to do to protect the players in the college game is the utmost priority.
Absolutely. All right. So this clip, I want you to look at the challenge itself, the placement of the challenge on the field, but also, most importantly, I want you to like a look at the reaction of the coach. So we see a strong foul in front of the bench. We have the referee dealing with this. It's the yellow and talking to, which, you know, some referees consider an orange card. So it's more than just a yellow card. It's more than just talking to, obviously. However, because of the placement of the foul, look at the coach. What's important here is the fact that this coach starts to yelling right here. He's not even looking at the referee. He's already yelling. He's already complaining. And as far as the coach's behavior, that's something that we're gonna have to recognize as the referees on a college level. This is not allowed. This is not okay. This is not something that we have to ignore. I absolutely realize how much of an importance coaches are in any professional game or college game. However, this sends the bad example to the other coach. This sends the bad example to any conference or any league that you guys officiate. This coach is not even interested what the call is. He's not interested in what the decision is. He's interested in complaining. He's interested in riding up his team. He's interested in riding up the fans to say that, hey, there is an injustice being done. This is deterioration to our presence on the field. This deteriorates our game management. Because of his behavior, the players no longer are willing to openly respect the decision that is being made by the referee. And that's something that we need to address.
So what you're saying, Robert, is the players are believing that the yellow card is being given here because of the coach's reaction.
Absolutely.
And in the college game, with all due respect, we do have coaches that take advantage of these situations, and it's the referee who allows it to continue throughout the match or puts himself or herself into a situation like this.
Absolutely. So I am not going to go to say this must be a yellow card. I'm not going to say this must be a red card to the coach at all. I'm not claiming what's the best resolution of the situation is. Well, all I'm saying is this cannot be ignored, because that's something that allows players to believe that this yellow card was shown only because of the coach's reaction. It's not because of the referee's decision.
Well, Robert, I would like to say then, as an assigner in the Northeast Conference of Women's Soccer, that if a coach behaved like this and influenced the referee's decision, even if the referee thought this was a questionable offense, he now can come and show the coach a yellow card.
Okay.
Because he's got to put a stamp on this, one way or the other. Whether he got the yellow card for the player right or wrong, the coach needs to be cautioned in the college game.
Thank you, Dr. Joe. I think it's important that we appreciate the backing on this. It's a difficult decision to do so in a college game. I think it's important for us to know that as the referees, if we see something like this, it's not like we're looking for this, but if we see this for the game management purposes, we need to be able to show coach the yellow card, because that's an inappropriate behavior.
And I would say,
I have a question.
Let me finish, Sir Richard. I would say that I would have full support from the commissioner, you know, for referee to give a yellow card here. If the commissioner wanted to look at the video, whatever, he would say, absolutely, we have to stop this behavior.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, no, 100%. I have a question from one of the referees in the chat. He's asking, at the college level, most of the time we don't have a fourth official until we get to playoffs. And since the AR1 is going to be preoccupied with other things, due to the fact that the foul was so close to the bench personnel, should the referee approach the bench and trying to calm things down and talk to the coach?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. First of all, the AR should not be preoccupied with other things. I see this a lot of times as a cop-out in a college level, and I don't mean disrespect to anyone. I know we all trying to do our best, but in this particular play, I know you're trying to stay with the second to last defender as an assistant referee, but there is no reason for you not to recognize that foul, and there is no reason for you not to see the behavior of the coach, because once that foul happens, the whistle is going to blow. Once the whistle blows, you don't have to look at your second to last defender at all. You are actually going to be able to recognize that coach's behavior better than probably than the referee does. Brian, I don't know if you can chip in for this one.
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing. That foul happens. I was just telling my daughter, she was listening, and I said, that foul happens 25 yards over the midfield line. To say that you're preoccupied with the last man on that type of play, you should be able to have your head on a swivel there. And as soon as you hear the referee's whistle, your attention should be turning to where that foul was.
Right.
And be able to assist and see and keep an eye on the bench. Because with no fourth official, you may be acting as a fourth official there to go down there and stop that bench from entering the field.
Correct.
Yes, you expect your fourth official to do it if they were there, and then you cover the fourth official spot. But if there is no fourth in a situation like that, where the entire bench gets up, the coach is screaming, you can see the assistant coach trying to get the players to sit down, you may have to actually go over the midfield line and act as a fourth to assist in bench control there until the referee is able to get in there to make sure that we don't have a situation where he's got to deal with players on the field and off the field.
All right. Thank you. Yeah, that's you know, at the end of the day, it's a team effort with the game management, and there are some things that referee needs to do and must do, but we also are looking from the assistant referees to help us with that. We also are, this is a team effort type of a situation, and ignoring this will really do a lot of bad to your game for this game and for the next games as well, because guess what, the coaches remember. All right, Dr. Joe, do you want to talk about body language and personality?
Most certainly, but this would be a good time, perhaps we just take a break from your presentation and bring Ryan in, because we're now going to talk about individual behavior, referee, body language, and mechanics and stuff. So we want to make sure we get Ryan in, so if he's still connected.
Ryan, no, he's not connected. He unfortunately has something to do. And he was only available to 8:30, but he promised to come back next week and actually have a great NCAA presentation for all of us, including the new rules.
Okay. Great. You mean they might be passed in time for next Friday?
So next Friday.
All right, then. This is an interesting slide. Robert has chosen to put the picture up of Ishmael Elfath, one of our FIFA referees here at the United States, and one who has had an extreme amount of success most recently. So yes. I had the good fortune to be his coach mentor for a time when I was with Pro, and to be with him in his first game. And the game was in Montreal, but not in the outdoor stadium, because it was an early season game, so they played indoors in the Olympic Stadium, which is a tremendous, huge building with a dome. And somehow the way the field is laid out, it doesn't even look like the goals are properly placed on each end of the field. Very difficult place to get a sense of where you are on the field. And he had a difficult game, and he didn't get too much help from an assistant referee that gave him a couple of flags that he didn't need. And he got into personal confrontations with the players, just like this picture is showing. And what I noticed then, and what I continue to notice about him, is that his body language reflects his personality. He's a strong individual. He knows what a good game looks like. He knows what he wants, and he's not going to let anyone take advantage of him. Okay? And whatever he says, and it'll be on our next slide, you can see, you'll see something that it doesn't matter too much what you say, but how you say it. But whatever he says, players buy. And they accept it for whatever reason. I think it's the one characteristic of this referee that has got him to where he is. Because, hey, not all calls, we all know, not all calls are, you know, 100% accepted by the players. And at times, we, with video assistant referee, we learn not all decisions are correct. But it's how you explain it and how you position yourself as a referee with body language. That can help you sell your decisions. So if we go back to the other side, back to the other one with Ishmael. Okay, you need to be calm but firm, strong when need be. You don't back up, and you don't let a player come at you where you now back up. You take your stance, you stay, you know, and you give a clear, simple, precise explanation according to the letter of the law. And you got to be really careful because you got to know that in some situations one team is winning, another team obviously is losing, some player, you know, player might be having a good game, not so good. Got to be careful not to make a joke, not to say anything out of context of the game, but quote the law, quote your opinion, to tell why you made the call, and tell the player to get on with it. Now we could go to the next slide. But any questions on that or comments, Robert?
No, I agree 100%. I think this slide shows how the body language and the command presence without verbal communication is important. It's much more important than when you speak to individual players, or even if you speak with a group of the players. You're going to be reaching with your voice, you're going to reach maybe 1, 2, 3 players that are close to you, but with your body language and your behavior on the field, professional, calm, but firm, you're going to be able to send the same message to all 22 players on the field and the benches. And that's why it's so much more important.
Okay, we can actually go to the next slide, the science behind body language. So, I mean, there's an art to this, and everyone can read the slide. Okay, finding the right balance in decision-making, communication and discipline. Proper use of body language can establish relationships on the field. It actually happens before the game even starts. Okay, how the referee first appears, you know, doing the warm-up while both teams are warming up, the referees are warming up. You may have communication with some of the players before the game, even the coaches, and you carry with you your reputation. And your body language portrays the level of confidence that you have going into the match. Like, this is my game. So you walk onto the field with that sense that this is my game, and you show the confidence and calmness, the firmness, authority, and even, you know, a human side. So if a player is injured, there's no harm. There's no harm to helping a player up. And especially in the college game, we're talking the college game, you know, you don't want to be touching players, but you can show the rest of the players on the field that you understand pain, you understand injury, you have empathy, if not sympathy, for an injury, and you can help the player up. You have to be really, really careful about what you say, and even what you say in a men's game might be what you say is something different in the women's game. You have to know, you know, what hat you're wearing and what game you're officiating.
Absolutely.
Adi, it's interesting in FIFA, you know, English is now the official language of FIFA, but if you watch Champions League, or more so Europa League, you know, you've got two different countries, teams from two different countries and a referee from a third country. And you have to wonder the level of understanding when a referee tries to explain a decision to someone from a different country. And English is supposed to be the official language, but not every referee has embraced it yet, but they communicate with their body language. Of course, in the college game, you most likely don't have that scenario, but body language is a key component of game management.
Yep, and that's, I'm sorry, let me just throw this one in. This is actually something we can train. Before, at the beginning of the session, we talked to Brian about physical aspect, but we can train this. We can train our body language. We can train our facial expression during this time. You can get to the bathroom in a front of the mirror, and you can start showing your expressions on your face. That's something that's absolutely helpful. Sometimes we think we show empathy, but it looks like we are laughing at somebody. One of my first game at college, I thought I am showing that I'm loose and I'm under control of the game. And the coach asked me, "Why are you laughing at me?" And only then I realized that the message that I was trying to send was not the message that they were receiving. And don't get defensive about it. Just go in front of the mirror and try to show a couple of different facial expressions, and you're going to be surprised how different the message is being received from the message that you're trying to achieve.
Excellent. I have good news for everybody here. We actually have a clinic in about 3 weeks about emotional intelligence and the psychology of refereeing, and we're going to be covering a lot of this stuff.
Okay.
Excellent. So, I mean, I doubt that very many referees have actually stood in the mirror. And, you know, and if you're doing only college games, sometimes you don't get to see them, the college game on TV. But most college games now are on the conference webpage. So it's very, very important to see what you look like when you referee. And you will be surprised that what you think you look like may not be the perception that you're giving to everyone else. And you want to modify some of that body language based on watching your own game films.
Absolutely. I just got a message that we only have about 10 minutes left, so I'm going to try to rush through a couple of slides. But the one that's for me personally, and I think from a lot of referees, is very important is the teamwork, the understanding of when can the other team member assist with the game management, the recognition of moods and a frustration. A lot of times when you're in the middle of the game, you're wrapped up into your own way of thinking about the game. The perspective of the assistant referees is big, because they can see much more that you can see. Sometimes as a referee, you zoom in into the play, you zoom in into the foul, you zoom in into the player who committed the foul and the player who received the foul, but we don't see the temperature of the rest of the team. We don't see the temperature on the bench. The amount of teamwork that is able to help you with the game management is big. As long as you have a good pregame, as long as you allow your assistant referees, your crew members, to help you recognize that. The perspective of someone seeing the play or seeing all the players from 40, 50 yards away as a training AR is big. And you should always invite that feedback, even if you decide not to act upon it or not to do what the AR tells you or asks you to do. This is the perspective. This is the feedback that can help you zoom out and kind of see what's actually happening on a field from somebody else's point of view. Dr. Joe?
Well, I'm looking at the slide and you haven't gotten down to the last bullet point. It was, when do they hinder game management?
Yes.
So the assistant referees have to read the game the same way the referee is reading the game. And they can be a big asset in game management if they give the referee the decisions and the advice that the referee needs at that moment. But they can only do that if they're also feeling how the referee. That's why 15, 10, 20 years ago, FIFA finally created teams. Yes. Teams of officials for the big matches, and you always see the same assistant referees with it, because now they're all on the same page and they give the referee the call they need for that moment, and not something that would actually hinder into their game management.
Right. So in terms of recognizing the moods, the teamwork is recognizing frustration, the crew of the officials are able to help the referee. Recognizing offenders, especially if the persistent infringement situation is involved, it's so much easier to hear from your assistant referee, hey, number three already committed four fouls. In the heat of the moment, sometimes as a referee, you don't recognize that. But if you get that information from your crew, it is so helpful to show both teams that you as a crew of the officials, you guys see it. The same thing with playing advantage. A lot of times we are so excited that we are playing that advantage that we lose the offender, we lose the guy who committed the foul. If you hear from your headsets or if you hear from your assistant referee saying this was number five who committed that foul, you can go back to that player and warn him that, hey, there was a foul, you committed it, we allowed the advantage, but you have to be careful with it. So the teamwork is crucial, but all parts of the officiating crew, we all need to be engaged for 90 minutes throughout the whole game.
You mentioned advantage, Robert. Prior to this, we had a conversation actually yesterday about advantage. And, you know, referees, I mean, are sometimes judged on how well they give advantage and players want advantage. But what we never consider sometimes is that a team may have an excellent free kick taker.
Right.
And I can remember when DC United had Marco Echeverri, for example. So they didn't want advantage. They wanted the free kick, you know, for anything inside of 30. So, I mean, you got to know the players, you got to know the teams. And obviously, and in women's soccer especially, sometimes they much rather prefer the free kick rather than advantage. And we're talking about game management here. And the reason they want the free kick is because so many goals in women's soccer are scored against, you know, goalkeepers who have limited footwork or inability to jump, even sometimes touch the crossbar. No disrespect intended. But we do see a lot of goals on free kicks in women's soccer, and applying advantage is sometimes not the best answer in managing their game.
Absolutely. So to wrap up, Dr. Joe, do you want to give that advice here, and then we'll be on your way, Rich?
Well, yeah, let's see. We're summarizing, I guess. I think the key thing is many referees now are doing college games, but also work in so many other games that at various different levels of soccer in America. And, you know, we want to bring the best referees into college, but we want to make sure you show up as a college referee understanding the college game and not micromanage it and taking away the flow, overcalling the game, or at the same time, don't be so cocky that you walk onto the field with an attitude that, you know, it's a piece of cake, you don't really care, you're not getting the same amount of money as the pro game, and you go through the motions, because the players will read that in a heartbeat, and you'll find yourself into real problems in a match.
Yep. So as a summary, the good game management involves college soccer understanding, and let me just quickly touch up on that. years ago, it was difficult to do any research on the teams or the players or their statistics. These days, it's a matter of showing up at the parking lot 15 minutes early and Googling the team and seeing who's the good player, who scores the most goals, who's the troublemaker, what's the name of the coach. Even if this is the first time that you're at that school, you are able to do research very quickly. And I would encourage everyone to try it. When I go to the school that I never refereed before, and I know that the best striker, number 10, I know his first name, and I know the guy who is being fouled the most on that team, which probably is going to be a playmaker, I know his name and I know coach's name. If I throw those first names to when I speak with them privately during the game, I gain so much respect because they don't know me, but they hear that I know them. They're going to give me a benefit of the doubt. I know what I'm doing. I did my research. I can help them because I just talked to them and I call them Kevin and I call them Alex. And they don't know who I am, and yet I know who they are. That's something that's very easy to do and gains so much respect from the game management standpoint. Next time you're going to call something against them, they're going to give you a benefit of the doubt. And that's part of the college soccer understanding that it's so easy to achieve. And yet I don't think a lot of referees do that. Alertness and prevention, talking about safety of the players. We're talking about college students. We're talking about young kids. They're trying their best. Sometimes they have more speed than they have quality. That's something that we can manage. Making sure that our body language and our personality allows players to show their skill set, and yet we allow them to not to get injured. Doing nothing is not an option, meaning that if we deal with the trouble coach, if we deal with the emotional player, ignoring this is not something we want to do, because this opens the door for other referee, for other players and for other coaches to act the same way. And it also opens the door to maybe less experienced referee going into their next game and seeing this type of a behavior and not being able to deal with this. So sending a clear message with your decisions, being firm and ready to act, and verbal, nonverbal communication, which is a very important thing. And that's all I have in the on our presentation. Dr. Joe, thank you so much for helping me out. And Rich, this is all we have.
I have a couple of questions, if you don't mind.
Sure.
So while you guys were talking there, I was actually working.
Wow.
So just give me 1 second. All right, this question is for Dr. Joe. Dr. Joe, what is...
Well, you know, last week when we had the technical problem that I couldn't be heard, but there were so many questions of like, what do I look for in a referee? And my answer was, I look for a referee who has it. So they asked me to define it. And I mentioned that I actually learned this presentation from Mike Pereira, the NFL rules analysis on Fox. And I took his presentation and I adopted it, not from gridiron football, but I adopted it for soccer. So it, what is it? When a referee has it, he sees a play. Number one, he sees a play with instant total clarity. Number two, he applies the correct laws of the game with the most recent interpretations. Three, he relies on background and experience. He or she relies on background and experience. That could be player background, could be coaching background, could be many years refereeing background, watching games on TV, attending games in person. Four, have a real feel for the game. We talked about this in the presentation today, what the Germans call Fingerspitzengefühl. feel for the game, know what's expected of you as a referee. And the best part of it, in my estimation, is use knowledgeable guesswork when not sure, because there are going to be many decisions where you know you're guessing, but the guess is going to be the correct result, the correct answer, when you use knowledgeable guesswork based on everything else that that we just talked about, especially feel for the game. That's what is it.
Thank you, Dr. Joe. Thank you. We have a couple of questions for Robert. And just give me a second. Let's see if we can. Serge is not available, so let's see if Serge is available. I would like him to ask you that question in person. Sergio.
Yeah, I'm here.
How are you? You're from New York. Say hi.
Hello,
to
everybody.
Hey, Sergio, how are you?
Hey, Rob.
How you doing?
Good hearing you again. Been a while.
Yep, for sure.
So what is your question, Sergio?
Okay, what are the biggest adjustments you need to make going from an MLS game to an NCAA game? As a referee for you, Robert, and I'm not sure if Brian is still there, as an AR.
Okay, so for me, the most important is the level of trust that I have to have with my crew, and it just comes natural, because when I go to the MLS game, I usually work with the group of 15, maybe 20 ARs that I work throughout the season, and I know each one of them. I know what they like. I know what they don't like. I know their personality, and I know what to expect from them. This allows me to trust them, and this allows me to know what to expect from them. When I go to the college game, many times I work with people that I know and I work with before, but there's times that I've never seen that official before in my life. I can expect him to give me all the information that I need, and I can allow him, maybe selfishly, but it's for the good of the game, I can allow that person to call every single foul for me. You know, it's my responsibility to make sure that we keep the level of the game that I want it to. So the biggest adjustment is to perhaps even work harder as the referee in the middle, so we don't screw up the players, we don't screw up the game. And for me personally, that's the biggest adjustment. The other one is also with the expectations of the coaches and the players of what's a foul, what's not a foul. I remember when I was coming up at the beginning, I felt there was a huge disconnect between what the referees were doing on the field and what the players and the coaches were expecting to be done on the field. And I think we were never really taught that we are all in this together. It's not us against them. It's not me against the coach. It's we are all big part of this beautiful game. Listening to their feedback, hearing them, even within a dissent, there's a certain portion of the truth. Maybe we are not sometimes in sync with what the players expect. And I think having that ability to hear what the coaches are asking for, instead of thinking that the coaches are a-holes and they just want to win the game, they don't care about us. I think that's the biggest switch that I had to do between the professional level and the college level. We all in this together. We need to try to listen to each other, and if we do that, I think we're going to be much more successful as the officials, and we're going to get much more favorable feedback from the coaches to the conferences and to the assigners.
Thank you, Robert. I don't know if Brian is there.
Yeah, I'm still here.
You want to give an answer as an AR?
My biggest issue coming down to a college game, I think I said it before. I don't know if Dr. Joe was on at the time. I only run basically two lines a year, and they're both for Dr. Joe. My biggest issue is applying what pro or FIFA standards are for my calling versus the experience of the referee in the middle. Like, I have to delay my flags because I'm used to having a VAR check, or I understand the difference between a touch versus a deliberate play, or a deflection versus deliberate play, my interpretation versus the referee's interpretation for offside calls. My vision around the field sometimes is not, as Rob said before, sometimes the referees get tunnel vision to the play and the foul, and then my vision is wider and may see an advantage or a player running through, but the referee doesn't see it. And how do I try to communicate that to a referee, whether it's my body language, my eyes, a simple hand signal to let them know that I want the play to continue because there's a possible advantage and we can call it back. That's my biggest, like Rob said, we all work with the same like crews in MLS. So the referees know me and I know the referees. We know our ins and outs. So when I'm on the line, a lot of times the referee I'm working with, sometimes I know, sometimes I don't. It's those things of me trying to bring myself back down one step or one level so that I don't put the referee in jeopardy because my flag is too late or my flag is too early or I saw something different than them. I'm there to assist when I'm AR, and I do everything possible in a professional manner to make the college game go smoothly for them.
All right, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. We have another question. This one is for Robert as well. This is from Andrew Kennedy. Andrew?
Yeah, how's it going, Rob?
Hey, Andrew. How you doing?
Sorry. Thanks for doing this. I know you went over a little bit of this in presentation, but I wanted to know, because especially for a young official, a lot of what we do in Western New York is talking about pregame, and especially working with people that you don't know, wanted to talk a little bit more about, hey, what can we do in a pregame to prep, and what sort of stuff you include in your pregames, whether that's in a pro level or at the college level, to make sure that we've got issues that can be resolved.
Okay, when you talk about issues, are we talking about just the live action game display decisions, or are we talking about players or coaches' behavior? Do you want to specify that, or just want to talk in general about a pregame?
I think, at least for me personally, it's going to be the coaches that's been my biggest problem.
Okay. The great tool that we have as a college officials is that we can always stop the clock, right? And that's something that you already took action. I've learned that when I stop the clock, the coaches already are on the radar that, hey, something is about to happen, or maybe something is going to happen. So in my pregame, if there is an information from my crew that requires my attention in regards to the behavior of the coaches on the sideline, and that's something that they believe I must find out during the game, then once they tell me, what I do is I stop the clock and I tell them that I'm going to go over to you if we don't have headsets, but you need to tell me specifically what happened. Now, it's important to clearly communicate what exactly happened. I had games before where I would go to the assistant referee and the assistant referee would say, this coach must go. Okay. Now, if you know that assistant referee, if you know the player, the referee on that crew, you trust him and you know that he wouldn't say those words lightly, you can trust it. But what I've learned in my experience, sometimes it's good to get into more of the details of what happened there, because the worst thing that you could do is you could act upon the information you received that was either incorrect or was incomplete. So it's important to get the whole story and find out what exactly happened. But once you stop the clock, there's a good chance that the coaches are going to wait for your decision. And what I do a lot is I go to them, and I don't want to have a conversation with them, because I want to just put them back to what they're supposed to be doing. So instead of asking them about what are you complaining about, oh, I had a good look, this was my decision, it those things don't matter, because they already disagree with you. So to put them to the point of redirecting conversation into, you don't have to agree with me, but this is the decision that I've made, and you need to act in a professional manner, usually redirects from his anger of the decision that he didn't like into reminding him that he needs to behave properly. And this goes back to what you asked about the pregame. The pregame about those situations is important, because if you get incorrect decision from your assistant referees, you are going to perhaps make a mistake in a game that it's not your fault, but at the end of the day, it is, because you are the one dismissing the coach or showing him a yellow card.
All right, great. We have one more and final question. And actually, we have two questions, one for Dr. Joe. This one is live, and that person does not have a microphone, so I'm going to ask you the question for him. His name is Michael Garcia from California. And his question is,
I'm not hearing a question.
I lost the question. I'll get back to that question in just a second. Let me go back to Robert now, and I'll get that question again. It's just there's so many people online. I apologize. Kyle, you have a question for Robert. Let's see if we can hook you up with Robert. Once again, we apologize. It's just that we currently have over 180 referees. And from a total of 600 referees that signed up for this. So to search one by one is kind of like very difficult, but we'll get to you. So here's Kyle with his question. Kyle from New York as well. Go ahead, Kyle.
Hi, good evening, everybody. Good evening, Robert. Just have a quick question for you. Can you just briefly explain your journey, when you started refereeing, what games you started refereeing when you first started, and some of the things that helped you get to where you are today?
Sure. Hi, Kyle. The last thing that I ever thought is that I would ever become a referee. I never thought that I would cross that line. I was always a player. I played back in my old country in Poland. I moved when I was 21. I just played, amateurish games in the New York area. When I was 35, I got kicked in the knee, and I tore my ACL and meniscus. The foul was not even called on that game. This was an indoor game, but I couldn't walk. I crawled my way out of the field, and I had my surgery done, and I had a very difficult time going back to my fitness. It took me 6 months to start walking again. One day when I went to my daughter's gymnastic class, the coach of that class said, why don't you try refereeing, because you know the game and chances are you're never going to get kicked in the knee again. And this felt like perhaps a good idea. I signed up for the high school, local high school association class. It helped me get back on my feet. It helped me to train. It got me motivated again. So that was in 2009. when I first started to be a soccer referee at the age of 35. It was very late. It was very unusual, but I started to like it a lot. I started doing high school games. Then I took the bridge class to start being a U.S. soccer referee. I started doing kids games very quickly. It was recognized by the local authorities that perhaps I know what I'm doing. Because of my soccer background. I started finding out about all these tournaments outside of the state. So I started going to Florida. I started going to Disney. I started going to Development Academy Showcase. I started going to Dallas Cup. And I figured, sat with my wife, and I said, for the next 3 years, why don't we just do this? Why don't I just do everything that I can and attend every single tournament that I can, to do the best that I can do, and then whatever happens happens. If it doesn't put me on the path to be a national referee or maybe MLS referee, then that's fine. I'm going to quit because I'm too old to play with it for many years. So I did that, and some people decided that I have a potential. Some people decided that they like me, and they gave me a chance. And that's basically it. Blew my whistle for the first time 2009. By 2013, I was already fourth official in MLS, and now for the fifth year, I'm a full-time whistle in at the pro.
So, and congratulations. And it has nothing to do with the people that you were working with. It has a lot to do with you. So about consistency, it's about setting up real goals, and it's about opening doors, knocking on doors, and keep knocking on doors. And like we've been saying it all along in RWISOA, be the best that you can be. And absolutely, Here's a clear example of Robert Sabiga, someone who started kind of late, as a referee, but look where he is now, and it's not like anybody gave it to him. He actually has to fight for it. So congratulations, Robert, and proud to have you being part of RWISOA. And here is the question for Dr. Joe. Dr. Joe, what is your post-game protocol for the NEC, number one, and number two, same referee? What does it take to be part of your referee pool?
Well, the Northeast Conference is a small Division I conference with teams ranging from the northernmost team up in New Hampshire to the southernmost team in Maryland, and then going out as far west as Pittsburgh. So one of the first things, and has nothing to do with the quality of the official, unfortunately, one of the first things is, where do you live? And, can you easily get to our games? Many of them being played on Friday afternoons or even, 1 o'clock in the afternoon if it's a doubleheader with the men. So what are we looking for an official? We're looking for someone who looks at the Northeast Conference as a serious Division I league. We recognize that we're not playing the highest quality of soccer, as judged by the fact that our champion, although recently our champion has done rather well in the NCAA tournament, but typically we would go to the NCAA tournament and get eliminated in the first game. Regardless, we want the referee to look at our game as a World Cup game, as the most serious game she's doing, and we're looking for someone who comes with that attitude, obviously, who has it, all of the things that we talked about. Post game, referees text me or call me if there's an incident that I need to know about. Certainly, if there's a red card, but any other incident. I watch many of the games live on the computer, so I'm already aware of some issues as they happen. I do the schedule. I do the entire schedule. Actually, it's already been done and posted on Arbiter. So we try to do the schedule early so we can get the best referees, because we're in competition with the other conferences for the best referees. Brian Dunn just made the comment, you know, I'm the only one that assigns him on the line. So it shows you the quality of referees we got. But you know, I mean, it's a combination. Get the job done, referee the game the way we'd like to see it played, and stay out of trouble.
Great information. Thank you, Robert. Thank you, Dr. Joe. Thank you, Brian.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you, Todd, Tori, and everybody else. This is something that we wanted to do at the local level, thinking we may have, you know, 5-10 referees every weekend, every Friday, and we end up like today, we had 501 referees registered. It's been amazing, and thanks to all of you for, you know, taking time from your busy lives and just give us an hour or two of your time and to share your experiences and your knowledge. We very much appreciate it. Next week, we have Tori Pencil, NYSOA Managing Director. She was on the webinar earlier today, and she was the referee for the 2019 Women's College Cup. She will be doing a beautiful presentation on the differences between the men's games and the women's games. And we're also going to have two guest speakers. And Ryan will come back and give us a full presentation on NCAA rule changes and some other stuff. So in behalf of RWISOA, NYSOA, Dr. Joe, Robert, Ryan, and everybody else, thank you for listening to us, and we hope to see you again on Friday. Thank you very much.
Thanks for having me. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. You're most welcome.